not think so, especially if you've ever had to deal with a club owner for an extended period of time. But getting a gig isn't, I repeat, is not the most difficult part of having a successful band. If you've gotten so far as to get a gig, and I mean any gig, for your band, you've accomplished something that so many other bands can only dream to accomplish. The thing is, booking a gig will be the easiest part of your music career if, and that means if, you learn the tricks and techniques of a successful booking. And guess what we're going to be discussing in this chapter, folks? We will discuss how to get a gig and how to conduct yourself once you actually get that gig. Now, the most important tool you will need when you're booking your band in any venue is a press kit. In the previous chapter, we discussed the different elements necessary for any halfway decent press kit. Now, we must also tell you about the value of an online press kit. You can make one available for download on your band's website and or your MySpace site in PDF or Word format. Just try to keep the file as small as possible, because few things in this modern world suck more than a press kit that takes 3 minutes to download on a broadband connection. Believe it or not, folks, we don't have those 3 minutes in the industry. We really don't. If that's too much to do, you can enlist the aid of SonicBids, which is at www.sonicbids.com, and they will provide you with such things as your stage specs, your upcoming gigs, and even some networking opportunities. Once you have your press kit handy, the next step is to get organized. Figure out where you'd like to play, then visit the venue on a busy night when the best bands are playing, and honestly assess if your band makes sense in this venue. If, for example, you are a death metal band, you are not going to go over well in a hunting lodge. After you've positively assessed that your band makes sense in the venue and you would like to play, do your research. Who books the venue? When is he or she available? How far ahead does he or she book in advance? The club's booking agents, or in some cases owners, don't have the time and the day to indulge people who cannot take the time to do something as simple as follow protocol. And not following protocol, frankly, could get your band, and frankly you, banned for life from the venue. Once you've figured out who's in charge of booking the venue's gigs, the next step is to get that person, and only that person, the press kit. In the most ideal circumstances, you would call the person ahead of time and arrange to meet him or her at a predetermined time and place where you can give him or her a copy of the press kit for review. If, however, you live in a city like New York or Los Angeles, you'd have a better chance of winning the lottery than getting a private meeting with a booking agent of the venue, though miracles have been known to happen. So the next best thing to do is to send the press kit via postal mail. Usually doesn't cost more than $4 if you send your kit priority mail, but for international rates, I would suggest you contact your local post office. Include a cover letter in your submission. There is much to be said for politeness and proper grammar. After you mail your press kit to whoever is in charge of that sort of thing, your next step is to follow up. Give the booking agent at least a week to listen to your submission. If the venue is a popular one, don't expect an answer for at least 10 business days. Phone the agent during the times that he or she will be present to take your call and to book your band. Be short, be sweet, and be to the point. Now is not the time to regale the agent with your tales of rock and roll havoc or how many people think your band is just the bee's knees. Ask the agent if she or he has received your kit, if she or he has had a chance to listen to it, and did she or he enjoy the music. And once you get through all that, you can then ask if that person had a date in mind for your band to perform. There's only two ways it can go from here, folks. One way, the agent says no. And if this is the case, thank him or her for his or her time, and move on to the next venue. Don't bitch and moan about not getting the gig, because it's not going to change anything. You're not going to get the gig either way you look at it. Just get yourself together and move on to the next thing. Who knows? A better gig may be waiting just around the corner from the venue that said no. And the other alternative is, of course, that the agent says yes. Hooray! Get the date, confirm it with all your bandmates, and thank the agent for getting your band the gig. Thank you notes, once reserved for the Riverside Drive Society snobs, are very easy to obtain from your local stationery store. Now, while you may think that this is a little trite and so not rock and roll, there is something to be said for common courtesy these days. And sometimes an extra step towards politeness and chivalry goes a long way, even with a club owner at the evolutionary level of the common housefly. So let's assume the best case scenario and your band gets the gig. Here's a list of the do's and don'ts that any band, regardless of their genre, should follow. First, do promote the hell out of the gig. At the very least, the minute you get the gig, get on the phone with all of the local papers and have your gig listed in the free listing section. And nearly every newspaper has one. Put the date on your website, post it on your MySpace site, and put it everywhere and anywhere you can think of. Also, ask the club if they allow posters and flyers of your band's gig date, and one would be very hard-pressed to find a venue that says no, and pollute the venue with your ugly mug on every available place of real estate. Now, a note to upstart New York City bands. New York City is perhaps the only major metropolitan city in the United States that has these laws, but since they exist, it is our duty to inform you of them. You can promote your band wherever you want in New York City and its boroughs, that is Bronx, Brooklyn, Queens, and Richmond, also known as Staten Island, except on what is deemed city property. What that means in a nutshell is that you can place your posters inside the venue windows and on various public bulletin boards. You can feel free to flyer the cars in the neighborhood. However, you may not place your poster on lampposts, traffic corners, fire hydrants, garbage pails, or on the scaffolding that clearly reads post no bills. That's, by the way, what it means. Post no bills means don't put your fucking poster up here. Also, you may not flyer in the subways, you may not push your posters on any subway waiting areas, and you may not post your posters on the outside of any storefront. And this includes in front of the venue. We personally know three, count them, three bands that have had one or more of their members incarcerated for postering where it wasn't permitted. And frankly, I can't think of a more stupid reason to be incarcerated. Now, the next to do is to arrive on time. I repeat, do arrive on time. That means if you're due to perform at 10 p.m., arrive by 9:30 p.m. at the absolute latest, okay? Let the onus of any delays be on the venue, not on you. Do make it your business to know the sound specs. Most venues today have all of their sound specs listed on their website. Make it a point to recognize what you need for the gig and don't show up shorthanded. It is better to come with too much equipment than not enough equipment. If you can meet with the venue sound man, if indeed it has one, a day or two before your gig to have a brief run through, so much the better. Do perform as though you were playing to a sold-out crowd at Madison Square Garden. It doesn't matter if 200, 20, or 2 people show up to watch you play. Perform your absolute best at all times. And yes, there are times that you are inevitably going to tank, but don't let it be for lack of trying. After the gig, do make plans, the sooner the better, for a repeat performance, especially if you did well. If the booking agent liked you and you drew a decent crowd, make arrangements to play there again. Who knows? Your band may get a regular gig there. That will help you retain your footing on the circuit, and it may even be used as leverage when booking other shows. Do arrive at the gig in appropriate regalia. Now, leather pants are great if you're in a rock band, unless, like me, you're a vegan, in which point, no leather, no fur, no nothing, which is fine by me. But if you're in a rock band and you're not vegan, leather pants are great. But don't let it be the only thing you wear on stage. Switch it up a little. There's no need to call in the queer eye for the straight eye, guys, but you should have at least 5 pairs of pants outside of your leathers. Likewise, cut up or reconstructed or whatever those hacks are calling it these days, cut-up shirts and cut-up jeans get tossed away by even the most desperate of homeless folk. So don't ever make those travesties or fashion a part of your onstage wardrobe. No matter how many drugs or blowjobs the fashion designer, and I use that term very loosely, is providing you. Have a little self-respect. doesn't hurt. And finally, unless you work in a bondage shop, don't wear your work clothes to your gig. And it needn't be stated that cleanliness and good grooming are de rigueur for stepping outside your door, let alone on stage. A shower, deodorant, and a splash of cologne before you set one foot on stage isn't too much to ask, even if you are a holdover from grunge or you believe that you were Louis XIV in a past life. Now for the don'ts. Don't expect a large payment on your first gig. There are bands that earn thousands of dollars with each gig they perform. These bands, though, have had years upon years of performing experience under their collective belts, and they draw hundreds of people into a venue each time they play. If this is your first gig ever, be thankful the booking agent said yes to you. If she or he tosses you enough to cover your gas for the evening, consider yourself successful. And with time and experience, and even successful gigs afterwards, you will have plenty of leverage to ask for larger sums of money in the future. Don't shortchange your audience in any way, okay? If you're due to play for 40 minutes, play for 40 minutes, and play as though those 40 minutes were your last 40 minutes on earth. Don't play only halves of songs, don't cut your set short, and don't cop an attitude if the audience wants to hear one song over another. Remember something, they are paying their hard-earned money to see you. Your job is to entertain them. Act like an insufferable jerk, and there won't be a next time. And finally, but definitely most importantly, is don't ever, ever show up for a gig too drunk or too high to play. Nothing shows a greater lack of respect for your fans, for your friends, for your professional associates, for your bandmates, for the venue and the booking agent, and for yourself, than to show up for a gig completely obliterated on drugs and alcohol, especially to the point that you cannot perform. And folks, if you think it just happens with sign bands or the 80s rock stars of the Sunset Strip, think again. I've seen it happen firsthand. Keep your drug and alcohol intake to a bare minimum. Better yet, let it be non-existent on performance night. Or don't bother booking the gig. Be advised, too, that bands who have rampant drug and alcohol problems, especially in today's music business, won't ever get the time of day from a reputable label or a booking agent or anybody else. Funds are very hard to come by these days, and reputable professionals aren't going to invest whatever they do have in a band that will put the money up their nose, in their veins, or throughout their liver. Okay? So, very simple. Either get your drinking and your drugging in check, or pack it in until you do. And if by chance you can't do it on your own, enlist the aid of a professional.